Yes, good afternoon. Thank you, Antonio, for the introduction. So indeed, I will show you our results about rapid screening tools for seafood authentication, but also more reliable screening tools for seafood authentication. And I would really like to point and stress out that this has been a very close and active interaction between four different partners. So although I'm presenting our work, it's a collaborative effort between ELVO, between ISITA, ZUT, and BioRex Food Diagnostics. So Antonio set already a little bit the scene. He already mentioned that less than a month ago, The Guardian published an article where they did a meta-analysis of different seafood studies and counted how many of the samples that were analyzed were actually labeled with a different species name. And that percentage was 36%. So that was actually quite high. So now, why would seafood be substituted? Maybe that's the first question that we should think about. And of course, there's always an economic gain or loss. There's always money involved. If you replace expensive species with cheaper species, you can get an economic gain of that. But sometimes it's also because the species that are mentioned on the menu, for example, are limited available, or because of the quotas that are limited, or just because of the fishermen that did not catch the species that were supposed to be there. It's also possible that it's unintentional, actually, so that some species are so similar to each other visually that sometimes just mistakes are happening. And another thing is, of course, that sometimes fisheries are happening in illegal areas, also unreported fisheries are there. So it can be to conceal these illegal fishery practices. Now, the consequences are, regardless of the financial gain and loss that I already talked about, are, of course, also from a conservation effort, difficult to assess if species are still being catched, although they are already at a very small population size, then they should actually not be catched anymore. Also, there's a health risk for consumers in terms of toxins and allergies. If different species are in the package than is mentioned on the label, this can have health consequences. And of course, articles like this in The Guardian causes a big loss of confidence by consumers. If you look at the European regulation, then seafood is actually divided into two big groups. You have unprocessed food products and you have the processed ones. And especially in the processed food products, it's often very difficult to identify the species that are present in the sample because they have been processed. All the morphological features are removed. They have been added with mayonnaise. They are filleted. There are fillets and things that are just very difficult to identify using classical taxonomic features. And here is where DNA-based identification may be a solution. So the premise of DNA barcoding, for example, is that each species has a unique DNA profile. And the workflow of DNA barcoding is quite straightforward. So we start with a fillet or a sample that we want to identify. We take a little bit of tissue of that, do a DNA extraction on that, multiply thousands and thousands of times a very small piece of the genome, and then we get a sequence, a DNA sequence. This DNA sequence can be compared to a reference database. So in this case, the unidentified sample, it's difficult to read here, but in the reference database, the result always came back as caught Hadus murwa. This is an ideal scenario. However, we know that there are a little bit of problems associated with this DNA barcoding because we have identified other scientists have identified errors in the public databases, meaning that there's a wrong name attached to the DNA sequence. Also, it generally takes 5 days until we get a result for such an analysis. It also does not allow quantification. And if you have multiple species in a certain food product, then DNA barcoding will also not work because the sequencing profile will be mixed and you will have all kinds of double peaks and you will not have a clear DNA sequence. So having said this scene, it should be clear now that there is a need for high quality reference databases when we want to apply DNA barcoding, but also that we would like to have actually faster screening tools and also tools that allow us to authenticate mixed food products. And so that is actually, these were actually the three main focuses of our task within the Seafood Tomorrow project. So first, we created a reliable reference database. So the different partners collected seafood, commercially traded fishes from the European market, which were identified by expert taxonomists. We generated sequences, in total 300 sequences from all these species, and we stored the metadata in a publicly accessible database. So everything is linked, where the sample has been collected, where it is stored now, the tissue samples, the DNA extracts, the protocols we used, and also the DNA sequences. We have also created a video tutorial to demonstrate how you can easily retrieve the sequences from this database to do your blast searches, for example, to identify your sequences. And what we wanted to show with this database is the application on real market samples. And for this, we designed a study to investigate whether substitution of cod and common sole in Belgium happens at different steps in the supply chain. And this figure here on this slide shows you the composition of the supply chain. So it's, and which was already mentioned in the previous talk by Jean-Jacques, and it's quite a complicated supply chain. And we typically all substitution studies have been focusing on the end part, so on retail samples or on restaurants. But few studies have actually investigated whether the substitution might already occur higher up in the supply chain. So that is what we wanted to investigate here using this reliable reference database. And to do this, we collected 132 cod samples from all different steps in the supply chain, and also common sole was collected. So these were 41 samples in total. And the condition was that these samples had to be processed. So if it was a complete fish, we did not analyze it, because then you can still see the visual, you can still use visual identification. So it was really focused on processed food products. And what we saw for cod is that three out of these 132 samples were substituted by very similar white fish cod from the same family as cod. We also see that this happened in catering. So the substituted samples are here indicated in red in the graphs. So we see one in the catering, one at the fishmonger, and also one in this case. So this nicely illustrated actually the application of this developed tool on market samples. And this is at this point under review also in the second special issue for Seafood Tomorrow in Food and Chemical Toxicology. And then our third test that we wanted to, or proof of concept actually that we wanted to create, was to see whether we can actually quantify the amount of, in this case, salmon salar in a mixed seafood product. Because you have this in these mixed seafood products, it often says 70% of the samples are 70% is salmon salar. So we wanted to check whether we could actually quantify this. And for this, we designed a species-specific droplet digital PCR assay for salmon salar. And the graph on the left, on the right, sorry, clearly illustrates the linear increase. If we added more salmon salar tissue to our samples, we also get a higher quantification there. Also, when other when tissue of other species were there. So this tool allows to semi-quantify the amount of salmon salar. It was not a perfect, and when we apply it on retail samples, the correlation was much less obvious than what I show here based on our laboratory samples. But it was able to semi-quantify the amount of salmon salar. And importantly, also, this allows to identify salmon salar in mixed seafood products. We applied it also, as I said, on the retail samples, where we collected 46 different samples. We noticed that many of these retail samples were actually poorly labeled, so there was no scientific name, for example, or a wrong customary name. So there was definitely room for improvement there. But actually, all the samples that mentioned Salmo Salar were indeed Salmo Salar. So we did not find any evidence of substitution for this species. So to conclude, the Seafood Tomorrow database, so our first aim actually, allows now to reliably identify seafood products if there's only one species in these products. With the HRMA tool, we can quickly identify the eight salmon species, also if they are occurring in single species food products, and very quickly, so within 4 hours. We also provided a proof of concept for Atlantic salmon in mixed food products, where we can accurately identify it. While quantification, there is still room for improvement there, to go from semi-quantification to real accurate quantification. And importantly, our market studies show, unfortunately, that substitution still occurs also in the European market, in different steps of the supply chain. And also that there are large differences between species. We found 2% in cod, 0% in Salmo salar, in Atlantic salmon, up to 17% in sole. So there is room for authenticity testing, I guess, to really have a transparent way so that customers can really trust what they are buying. That was the end. Thank you for your attention.